very, very inquisitive in terms of, my goodness, water, water in church. Children, I promise you, during the service, you sit nicely where you're supposed to sit, and when the baptism takes place, you will come to the front. Is that all right? Little ones, you will be right here with me, so you'll be able to see everything. Now, the Pathfinders seem ready. We seem to have the technology in hand, so it's very likely that we are ready to go. I believe we have live streaming going on as well, so welcome to our audience who's watching us remotely, family members and friends. It's lovely to have you all here. The Pathfinders will start us off, and then the program will run almost unannounced. Thank you very much, Pathfinders. Now we would like to invite everybody please to stand as we sing our opening hymn. Thank you.
hand of God is touching people's lives, changing it, and making them live again. But we are going to witness kind of a burial and also a quick resurrection. I'm going to witness this four times today. May something be done in our hearts as well, that the desire would be born, that we want to live again, and we want to live eternally with you. So with this, Lord, please touch us through songs, through prayers, through your word, and through the action of baptism which is taking place here. Lord, we all carry a baggage, and we all want to get rid of it. Help us to make that decision to be free. We all search for a clean conscience, and help us to go to the source, which is Jesus, that we can start a new life today. Lead us, Lord, and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
but you're a masterpiece. You probably feel like a catastrophe. You want to be every day saying, ugh, like masterpiece. And it really haven't had to be. Now hold up, listen, y'all. You are totally different. You got a whole new position. You are a running Bobby Ricky, whole new addition. You think I'm totally kidding, but hold up a minute. Don't compare yourself for none of the devil. You want to want to be no synonym. A master artist, take a miss and make a masterpiece. And look at you, you better shine and shine.
Can I take my heart forever?
A number of people have made a decision to follow the Lord Jesus. Now, there are a lot of Christians out there, but these, our young people, have said, okay, there is enough running away from God. I would like to run to God. If God is over there, generally speaking, our tendency is to run this way, away from God, rather than run to God. Now, we all find ourselves in that situation every now and again. We run away from God rather than run to God. But what happens along life's journey is there are moments, there are times when we pause and we reflect and we realize running away from God is not life-giving, is life-taking away. Because life is found in the presence of God. So when that happens, people stop. People take stock. And people say, okay, enough running away from God. It's time to turn around and run towards God. And when that happens, people mark it with a symbol. In the Christian faith, that symbol is baptism. Now, I would like to leave three images with you in terms of what baptism is. Because you will see people coming as they are, getting in the water, all the way under the water. Better get under the water, or I'll hold them there until they're fully covered. And then they'll come all the way back up. Because baptism symbolizes a number of things. First of all, baptism symbolizes death. Okay, I know it sounds morbid, and I got my most morbid suit ready to illustrate that, okay? Death. It is a death to the past that I have, the past where I lived away from God. It symbolizes I have gone, I have done, I have been places, and I have been involved in things, but there is an end to that. So when people go into the waters of baptism, they say, enough is enough. I want that old buried and done away with. Are you with me so far? Mm-hmm. Yes? So baptism is like
death,
okay? Death to the past, which was away from God, and a new beginning. Talking of new beginning, that's the second image that I would like to leave with you. Starting life with God is like being a newborn. No, I'm not trying to tell you anything. I need to clear that one. All right? Turning away from God and then turning back to God signifies a new beginning. Jesus says to a man who was very interested in these things, he said, look, you've got to be born again. That means you've got to start afresh. Start reconsidering your choices now that you have turned towards God. So, you have made certain choices in the past. Now, before you make those same choices, you pause and you think, is that how life with God is lived out? Or is it not? It is a new beginning. It is a fresh beginning. And any one of us know how difficult change is. Am I right? It takes a lot of courage and it takes a lot of energy, emotional, physical, and spiritual energy. Our young people have said, enough running away. We want to put an end to that. We want to start fresh with God. We want to begin brand new. We want to be babes in the Lord Jesus. And I know it's coincidental, they're all four girls. All right? It's love. But baptism is not only like a new beginning as well. Baptism is, the Bible uses the imagery of a wedding. And that wedding dress, the majesty has not worn it for 20 odd years. So I sought permission to get it out of the box. I know. Use your imagination. The Bible talks about when you turn towards God, He is so committed to you as a person. He's so committed to you as a Christian. It's pretty much as though He marries you. He takes you to Himself. In actual fact, the Bible talks about a marriage of the Lamb. That's Jesus Christ and His church. That's you and me. So when they come out of the waters of baptism, they are clean, they are brand new, they are fresh, and they are ready to commit to a life with the Lord Jesus in the same way in which a husband and a wife commit themselves to one another. Four young people today said, enough is enough. We want to put an end. We want a fresh beginning. We want a lifelong commitment to God. And we commend them for their choices. Am I right, church?
Yes.
It is brave. It is courageous. It is wonderful. I would like to acknowledge them for the choices they have made. And they, you will hear from them in just a minute. I would like to acknowledge their families. Because it is not easy in today's society when we are faced with a multitude of choices out there. It takes a strong family to keep their children close together. It takes a strong family to keep their children close to God. And not all of us are fortunate to have strong and good families. And that is where the church comes in. Because I believe it doesn't only take a village to raise a child, it takes a church to raise a Christian. Do I get an amen to that? And that is where the rest of us come in. Because they would have made a decision today and every one of you would have played a part. Every one of you would have been a stepping stone. Every one of you in one way or another would have contributed to their journey. And I thank you for that and I believe they will be grateful for that. But do not think this as being the end of a journey. They will continue to need help just like the rest of our young people do. So church, this is not the end of a journey. This is the beginning. It's a lifelong journey. Any one of you who have been a Christian for a long time, you know that it is not easy, am I right? It's uphill sometimes, and sometimes even after you are baptized and say yes to God, you still find yourself going in this direction. And that's where the family and that's where the church comes in, tapping you on the shoulder and saying, wrong direction. How about turning back to life and away from death? We need to hang together. We need to support one another. We need to help one another. Because I believe one day, very, very soon, I really believe it's very soon, we shall stand in the presence of life itself, God Himself. And the only way we will stand there and we'll get there is when we support one another. Church, we can't live Christian life on our own. Never did Jesus encourage us to live it on our own. He always said, stick together, be united, pull close to one another. So we will celebrate for their baptism. We'll celebrate their choice. We'll celebrate their decision today. But I want you to commit yourselves to continue to support these four young ladies, to continue to encourage, to watch after them after today. And should they stray, wrap your arm around them and remind them that they are dead. They made a commitment to be dead to their past. They wanted one day to start afresh.
and they want a lifelong commitment to life itself, the Lord Jesus. Are you ready to commit to that, church? Yes? Thank you. Thank you for that. Now, I wonder what commitment is it that they would like to make. So, Uncle Everton, click us on, please. There will be a song or a mime right now, and then we will hear from them, and we'll hear the commitment that they would like to make.
Church, this song I want to sing is a mixture of English and Yoruba, but it means I worship you, God. Enjoy.
Summarize some of the things that we spoke about, some in detail, some less detail. There are 13 questions that I would like to pose to you, and only at the end I will ask you to say I do. I think I even rhymed that. Okay. All right, so I will read the questions, okay? And you can give the audience thumbs up if you want, nods, shakes, and that. So here it is. It's a commitment that you make, and we spoke about this briefly in our study. So, Do you believe there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons? That's the Trinity. Yeah? Yeah? Oh, almost all right. There we go. We've got the yes over there. Do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the atoning sacrifice for your sins and believe that by God's grace, through faith in His shed blood, you are saved from sin and its penalties? Yes? All right. Thank you. Do you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, believing that God in Christ has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart? And do you renounce the sinful ways of the world? Yes? Okay. Thank you. Do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ, your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary, and accept His promise of transforming grace and power to live a loving, Christ-centered life in your home and before the world? Yes? Thank you. Do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, the only rule of faith and practice for the Christians? And do you covenant to spend time regularly in prayer and Bible study? Yes? All right. Thank you. Do you accept the Ten Commandments as a transcript of the character of God and a revelation of His will? Yeah? Is it... That's the one. Is it your purpose by the power of the indwelling Christ to keep His law, including the fourth commandment, which requires the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord and the memorial of God's creation? Yes? Thank you. Do you look forward to the soon coming of Jesus and the blessed hope when less mortal bodies we have shall put on immortality? And as you prepare to meet the Lord, will you witness to His loving salvation by using your talents in personal soul-winning endeavor to help others to be ready for His glorious appearing? Yes? Thank you. Do you accept the biblical teaching of spiritual gifts and believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the Church of the End? Yes? Thank you. Do you believe in church organization, and is it your purpose to worship God and to support the church through your tithes and offerings and by your personal effort and influence? Yeah? Thank you. Do you believe that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and will you honor God by caring for it, avoiding the use of that which is harmful, abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, sale of alcohol beverages? Same goes with tobacco. Same goes from misuse of trafficking in narcotics and other drugs. Yes? Thank you. Do you know and understand the fundamental Bible principles as taught by our church? And do you purpose by the grace of God to fulfill His will by ordering your life in harmony with those principles? Yes? Thank you. Do you accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion and desire to be so baptized as a public expression of faith in Christ and His forgiveness for your sins? Yes? We'll be a wee bit late if you were to say no to that. Do you accept and believe that Seventh-day Adventist Church is the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and that people of every nation, race, and language are invited and accepted into its fellowship? Do you desire to be a member of this local congregation of the World Church? Yes? Thank you. Now, these are the commitments they have made. So, I would like to move in this congregation that they be accepted into membership here in this church, subject to them being baptized. Do I get a second for that? Thank you. All in favor to accept them as members of this church after they are baptized, can you indicate by raising your right hand? Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Ladies, I'd like you to sit there. I think Mimo, you're going to come first and you're going to share something.
Yes. So I'm here to tell you my testimony or story. I'm just going to start. So, born into the church, I've been a child of the Lord from day one. That's right. That's me. I'm God's son. My testimony is never limitless and large in number, so I won't bore you before I've even begun. But the most important aspect is God has saved my life time after time. You know, sitting in hospital, I felt myself dying, and it's happened often enough for me to recognize this feeling. But through the paralyzing fear, I would look up to the hills for where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord, my God, who made heaven and earth. Psalms 121. And just like that, I was given another chance. I strive to be a cut above the rest. I wanted to pass the test, to be deserving of that boundless love that I so often read. But the more I pushed ahead, the more I seemed to fall behind. The more I realized that I needed to be refined. My philosophy just refused to be aligned. Every day I would wake up and my faith was escaping me. My passion was passing me. The people I was surrounded by, the so-called Christians, who were supposed to be a light in the dark, were shrouded in darkness, and I realized I could no longer see the light. The places in the church which were once filled with peace were now shrouded in my own misery. Instead of looking for proof, I was looking for holes in the truth that I had established. You know, I lost energy for it all, church, Pathfinders. How could there be so much pure evil in what was supposed to be God's house? My own mind was filled with questions, and I had started to turn away from my God. The word faith, it lost its meaning. I had instigated a fight that was dictated by my own mind. It was, what it seems, an argument against myself. But I am my parents' daughter, and I am a child of the Lord. If I was ever taught one thing, it was to fight for what I believe in. I had to take a step back, re-establish my faith. I had to look away from humanity, to stop basing my faith on other people and look into the beauty that God had placed all around me, in a thing so close that I couldn't see, my family, my friends, my ability to exist itself. So this time, I will not chase after a ridiculous notation of perfection. I am his plan. I am wonderfully and fearfully made. The other thing I learned from baptismal class is the power of God, mercy and grace to invite God daily into my personal space. This place, this sanctuary, is built for us to worship, to look past the bad and to focus on the blessing. Come to service every week, open-minded for the lesson that God has prepared for me. I am underserving, but I am grateful that I am able to dedicate my life back to you. To God, I promise to strive to stay faithful, and maybe finally, not only me, but you will be able to see the masterpiece that is me.
Thank you very much, Mimo. Now, there is no greater privilege in this world than to be able as a pastor to baptize your own child. So Mimo's dad is going to baptize Mimo just now. Now, I would like to invite the little children to come here at the front. Not on the platform. Just here, that's it. I need you all now to sit down, please. There are people behind you that need to see. Okay, sit down. Okay, nice. Okay. Those, I don't want anybody on the platform, okay? I do not want accidents, okay? That's lovely. We have space here. If anybody wants seats, that's it. Okay, that's good. Okay. Can you see? Everybody sits nicely, okay? Can you see? Yes? All right, can everybody else see? No, I'm sorry. It may be that you will need to stand as the opportunity is, okay? Now, after each candidate is going to be baptized, okay, thank you, after each candidate is baptized, just as they come out of the water, they have chosen a song that is their favorite song, so we will invite you all to sing their favorite song as they come out of the water, okay?
Was 3.5 months. when she spoke.
Mommy, tell me.
And from then, she did not just say a word, it was sentences.
Something in there. That's cold.
She kept
how do I get
doing many great
how
things.
How do I get
she saw that things very good. And
good.
Also, by our thinking, would want to act just very fast. So I devised this sort of verse. Whenever my daughter is running to act, I'll just say, Mimo, be careful. One day, this is about maybe 12, a year, the man came to me and said, Dad, I said, yes, you know what? I said, what is it? I ain't careful. When you say be careful, I shake my head. I ain't careful. Don't say careful anymore. I think from this first sentence, you will understand how wonderful our pastor, Pastor Marcel. And Cedric and his team have done. I want to thank each and all of you and the church. You have done wonderfully well. Mimo is someone that thinks and it just stood like this. The friends, you have been very wonderful. I want to thank all of you. This is not a single, as Pastor said, a single work. It is a team work of the whole church. I thank you. You have done well. Please continue to be there for me and my family. God will be there for you too. Pastor myself, said, thank you all. Mimo, the Lord will keep you. Upon your confession and declaration. From henceforth, to remain as a newly born child of God and to continue with him as into Christ being the husband of the church, you being the wife of Christ, symbolically. I therefore baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Like to invite Kezia to come up and she will share her testimony with us and then we'll have the baptism.
Good afternoon, church. For those who don't know who I am, my name is Kezia Hamisi. I was born into an Adventist family and taught about the Bible from a very young age. As long as I can remember, honouring the Sabbath, giving thanks to God, and going to church with what was right. When I was a child, my sister and I used to spend our summers at our grandparents' place. Sorry, so we weren't born there, so it was just me and Simon. We loved it there, as all our cousins would also be there too, so it was like an extended sleepover with all our best friends. Every morning we'd wake up at the crack of dawn and pray, and every evening we'd do the same before bed. I always really admired my grandmother. No matter what came her way, she believed that it was part of God's plan. She truly was devoted to Christ and wanted us to be the same.
Despite this, as I grew older, I experienced a crisis of faith. I developed a terrible habit of comparing myself to others, especially atheists for some reason. I wondered why God had, I wondered why they had what I thought were the best opportunities, the best cars, they went on the most amazing trips. Why was God blessing them with all these shiny new things and not us? It wasn't until I got older I realised I was seeking happiness and fulfillment in the wrong places. The turning point for me was when I went back home to Malawi for a holiday for a month or so. Seeing how happy people were with so little was eye-opening. Instead of wondering why they didn't have certain things, they praised God for what they did have. Studying the Bible with Pastor Marcel and the girls, it really helped me see how lucky we were. Because no matter what, God would always accept us and love us. I knew I had to build a relationship with God and allow Him to steer every part of my life. That's why I'm here today, to commit myself to God, and I look forward to my spiritual journey. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Philippians 4, verse 13.
Comfortable, so it's not a problem. All right, everybody sitting nicely?
Yeah.
Good, good. Now, Kezia, you have had an amazing journey with the Lord Jesus, and your family played an important part in where you are today. And we thank God for that, and we thank God for the way in which He worked in your life. But there's a bright future ahead of you, and I believe of all decisions in life, this arguably is the most important. So, it gives me tremendous pleasure at this point in time to baptize you in the name of God our Father, the Lord Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit who will fill you up and carry you in His arms all the way to heaven. Gabriella will share her testimony with us.
It seems like an obvious choice, having grown up in the church, to make this decision. Being a Christian was all I knew. At home was Sunday Adventist, and at primary school it was Catholicism. Even though I had various faiths and beliefs, I never really to respond. Following this, I began Bible studies with him. me to get away from depression. I no longer felt like life was worth living, and at one point, for a few seconds, believed God was dead. I felt completely empty. Comforted by the darkness of my wardrobe, I cried and begged God for forgiveness, and promised I'd never forget him again. The next year would be filled with feelings of desperation and many points of suicidal ideation. Depression and anxiety were things I'd heard of, but never imagined myself having them. I believed this meant I was weaker, or that God had forgotten me, or maybe my life was so boring that I began making things up. Even though holding on to God was my only lifeline, I felt alone, and as though I was living a life that wasn't my own, so I attempted the unthinkable. Let's just say, thank goodness for innate human reflexes. Despite feeling like I was going through an out-of-body experience for weeks on end, I wanted to recover from whatever was happening. A relapse was something I never believed would happen. Subsequent to a traumatic experience came severe anxiety and depression. Simple things like walking across the hallway to go to the bathroom felt too scary or embarrassing. Everything was overwhelming, and once again it seemed like there was no way out. Now, I've heard, be still, and know that I am God, but I never really understood what this meant. On the brink of this life-threatening decision, a voice similar to my own said, this isn't what Jesus wants you to do. What are you doing? From that point, I told myself, no, God has something much bigger for you. Of course, my situation didn't magically get better. It took months until I actively sought help, but contrary to what some might believe, in my self-isolation and modeled up routine, I felt closer to God. I knew he was with me because I'd heard him talk to me. Finally, I'd found my Jesus. Learning to listen to that voice isn't always easy, especially as we, or at least I do, naturally tend to be quite busy in our minds. I've learned that being still to hear that voice doesn't always mean having a clear mind. Sometimes we have inclinations to do a certain thing or certain observations stand out to us more, and that too can be God talking to us. After all, we do communicate to each other in more ways than one. And because relationships are a two-way street, the way we behave or actively think can also bring us closer to God. I'm still finding my feet, but I'm much better than where I was a year ago. After all, my God is a great big God. He plants my feet on higher ground, and because he is for me, no one and nothing can stand against me. As I begin this journey, I ask you to help me keep on the narrow way called Christianity. As I come to a close, I'd like to leave you with one of my favorite Bible texts from Philippians 4. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things.
Gabriella, yours is a unique and amazing journey. Not many people walk that road that you have walked, and yet here you are today, in spite of everything and in spite of anyone, you are ready to commit your life to the Lord Jesus in full faith. Now, Gabriella, there are no promises other than God will never, ever give up on his children. So, as you begin this journey, I pray that you will sense the love of God the Father each and every single day. I pray that the Lord Jesus will be so real to you, especially when the dark clouds are gathering around you. And I pray that the Holy Spirit will fill your mind and your heart and your body in such a way that nothing and nobody will enter there. So in the name of God the Father, the Lord Jesus, and the Spirit of God, it is our privilege to baptize you today.
You. Family here, family far away. And you have committed yourself to different things, studies, even with us, with our Bible studies, and you're faithfully there. And I pushed your buttons and I put some pressure on you every now and again. But you've got a lovely personality about you, and I believe that God will use you for His glory. So, in the hope and with the full knowledge that God is going to take you from here to His kingdom, it is my pleasure to baptize you in the name of our God the Father, the Lord Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most important decisions that are out there to be made. Living life with God rather than without God, I tell you, it's a no-brainer. So if any of you would like to start this journey with God, I would like to hear from you. Pastor Janusz and myself, we are here to study together, to answer your questions, to prepare you to understand better how to live life with God. We would like to start a Bible class for children under 12. If you would like to be baptized, and if you're under 12, come and talk to us. If you are over 12, come and talk to us. If you are anywhere between 25 and 95, come and talk to us. If you're over 95 and haven't made this decision, come to the pool now. You know, whatever you do, do not delay it. Do not delay it. Because there's no point living life without God. Am I right? So come and speak to myself and Pastor Janusz there at the back at the end of the service. Write to us, tell us, and we will study. We'll have Bible studies together as groups and individually, whatever is comfortable. Now, we are going to go and change. Our worship group here is going to sing a couple of songs, lead you in singing. So what I would like to ask the children to do now is to please make your ways back to your seats. And thank you for being so welcome. Thank you for being so well behaved.
So the first song we're going to sing is Near the Cross, 312.
Thank you. Thank you. Mountain high, the river wide, he tells the sun where to set.
talk about baptism being a new beginning. Nobody stands a chance on their own. We need help, and we need help from the only one that can see us through this Christian life, and that's God. So now we are going to have a prayer of blessing, asking for the presence of the Spirit of God to be manifested in their lives. We'll lay our hands on them, and we'll ask the Spirit to take over. To that end, I would like to invite you all to stand. Dear God, we stand here today as a testament of the fact that you are ever present in every one of our lives, but especially in the lives of these wonderful four ladies today. Dear God, we thank you for their journey so far. We thank you for the way in which you have led each one of them. We do look ahead, and we have no idea what lies ahead. But you do. So this afternoon we would like to pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to be manifested in their lives in an amazing way. Lord Jesus, evil will surround them, but you have defeated evil already. Dear God, there will be difficult choices to make which lie ahead, but you are the source of all wisdom. Grant them wisdom. Dear God, sometimes they will feel weak. They will feel unable to make some of these choices. But with you, nothing is impossible. So we pray for your power to be manifested in their lives. Dear God, there will be different spirits knocking on their hearts and their minds' doors. We pray that your Spirit will cast those away, and your Spirit will control their lives from today onward. Dear God, we may not always be there, we can't always be there, but you have promised that nothing will ever separate us from your love. So we claim that promise for our four young ladies today. May your Spirit never depart from them. May he grab hold of them and take them from this world to the next into your arms forever. Dear Lord Jesus, may your love surround them each and every. May they know how precious they are into your sight. God, love them and grant them your grace to live with themselves, to live with others, but most importantly, to live with you each and every day. Dear God, today is a remarkable day, but it will pale into comparison with that day when they will stand in your presence forever and ever and ever. Grant them that privilege. Grant us that privilege, we pray. In the name of the Lord Jesus, who can do much more than we could ever dream or imagine. Amen. Ladies, it is at this point in time that we would like to congratulate you for your decision. So I would like to invite my elders, please, to join me here at the front. All right? We'd like to thank you for your decision, and we'd like to extend you the right hand of fellowship, they say, into our church. God bless you, and thank you for your decision and for inspiring everybody here. Thank you. If anybody from the congregation would like to congratulate them, please come forward. This is the time with the Pathfinder leaders. We have youth leaders here with us.
next song is There Is Sunshine in My Soul Today.